Well, good morning, everyone. Come on in and find your seat. It's good to see everyone here this morning. On the spring forward morning, we all lost an hour. This morning, I woke up later than I normally do in a rush. I did get here on time, and I was wondering what was so wrong with me, but on the way here, I looked at my car clock and noticed it said 6:45. And my watch said 7:45, and I was like, that's why I feel so terrible right now, is that I've lost an hour of sleep. But it is so good to see all of you here this morning. Thank you for gathering with us. And if you're a guest this morning gathering today, we're so thankful that you're here. And we'd love to connect with you. If you don't mind sharing some information with us by simply scanning the QR code that's on the chair in front of you, if you scan that QR code, it'll bring up just a little contact form. We'd love to know who you are and that you are visiting with us. And we'd love to also be able to send you a coupon via email for a free cup of coffee at Crazy Love Coffee House. Now, I do have to say something about that this week as well. All of the church basically got a free cup of coffee coupon from Crazy Love, and Perry and Sandra were probably like freaking out in the back there. But I did correct, if you're a member, regular attender, you can't use it. Okay, that was my mistake. But if you're a guest today, we'd love to send you the coffee. So fill out that QR code, and we'd love to know you were here. We do have some special things coming up in the life of our church this month. We're looking at our Easter weekend events, and the first is Good Friday. That's on March 29th, and it's from 5:30 to about 6:30. And this is a time where we just gather together as a church to remember the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus, Him shedding His blood for our sins. This is one of my favorite gatherings that we do at Lebanon. It'll be on Friday at 5:30. Make sure that you mark your calendars to come. And then Resurrection Sunday is March 31st, and it begins with a sunrise gathering over at Greenlawn Cemetery, which is not far from here. We meet at Greenlawn, and right around 7 o'clock as the sun is beginning to rise, and we just mark that occasion of the Lord's resurrection. It's also a sweet time because many of our members are buried over in Greenlawn, and to think that one day they'll be raised incorruptible when the Lord Jesus comes back, it's a really special gathering. So we invite you to that at 7 a.m. and then 10 a.m. So different than 10:30, you'll have to come a little bit earlier, but we do that so that we can kind of get you out before 11:30-ish so that you can kind of get where you need to be. 10 o'clock is when you're going to want to be there for the morning gathering, and that's also one of my favorite gatherings when we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. A couple years ago, my aunt was here, and she was not a believer, and in that service, she accepted Christ. It was that morning that my father put his faith in Christ, so Easter Sunday's got a special place in my heart. I love singing and talking about Jesus' resurrection and his life-changing power over our hearts. Planning Center, I know you're so tired of me saying this, but this is going to change your life and mine, okay? And what I'd like you to do is, first of all, if you've downloaded the app, you're going to want to update the app because they've fixed a couple of bugs. One of them is the directory. Now the directory is fully showing. But here's what I would love to do, okay? So everybody, I need you to do this. The directory is only as good as the pictures we put up there. So it's super duper helpful to have a current picture of you on the directory. Don't put a picture of your goldfish or anything like that. Just you. You can put an animal in there with you, but we want to see you. There's also a cool option for those who have families. There's a family household photo, so you can put your big family picture on that one, and then for your personal profile, just put one of you, and that makes it so easy for somebody to find out who you are, make that mental connection. It helps connect the body together, so make sure that you do that ASAP. And if you're not listed in the directory, make sure that you do list yourself so that people can get to know you better. One other announcement about Planning Center, and this is in regard to giving. Tomorrow, we're going to disable giving through our old system called Realm. And there's going to be about a day of reboot. And on Tuesday, we're going to launch the new giving through Church Center. So Carla has emailed those who have recurring gifts set up. We'll let you know all about that. But just so you know, this week we're switching over to Church Center as a way to give. It's super easy. You can text to give. You can give in the app. And you can give online as well. There's two last things. April 7th, we're going to have a members meeting in the evening, and that's at 5 o'clock. So make sure, members, that you put that on your calendar. We're going to give you an update on the building on April the 7th at 5 p.m. And then finally, last week we talked about the missions emphasis and the Ball Ground Church plant. And then Pastor Josh preparing to go to Utah. And we wanted to just let you know, you can still give to that Missions Emphasis Fund. You were emailed this week on Friday the information to give towards Ball Ground and to give towards Utah. So if you'd like to do that and you've got money set aside for giving to missions, we recommend that fund to you. Just check your email. If you have any questions, you can ask me or one of the pastors about that. Well, that is all the announcements, I promise. And now we're going to turn our attention to the scripture this morning that's going to be guiding our singing and our thoughts, our scripture readings and prayer. It comes from Exodus 34:6, and this is the moment when Moses asked if he could see God, and God says, well, you can't see my face and live, but I'll pass by you, I'll hide you in the cleft of the rock, and I'll put my hand over you, and I'll pass by you, and you'll see me as I pass by. And as the Lord passed by, this was spoken in Exodus 34. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. I am glad that we have a God who is slow to anger, aren't you? A God who is patient with his people. A God who is merciful, who looks beyond our faults to see our true need, that we need forgiveness and salvation and cleansing and healing. He is a God abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Would you pray with me and let's thank God for these truths? Father, we come before you this morning and we're humbled to think that you would stoop to rescue us from our fallen condition. Lord, we know that you're a God who is high and holy, that your eyes cannot look upon sin, that the stars are not pure in your sight. But Lord, thank you that you are also a God who is slow to anger and full of compassion, and you love sinners, and you love showing mercy to sinners. And so we pause this morning, Father, and thank you that you're God who's a merciful God. We pray, Lord, that we would remember these truths and that as we sing, our hearts would be yielded to your Holy Spirit. As we wonder and marvel, and can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Lord, thank you for these truths. We pray now that you would help us as we worship you, to worship you in spirit and in truth. And I pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's all stand together and we'll begin singing of our God's love for us. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Let's sing together.
Should gain an interest in the Savior's blood. Died he for me who caused his pain, for me who hid him to death. Father's throne above, so free, so
singing of the mercy of God, wonderful, merciful Savior.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and you find always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger.
Chose to set his love upon us. That choice is not an afterthought, it's an eternal thought. It's a thought that was there in God's mind before he even created the world, that he would pour out his love and compassion and forgiveness on you. Let's sing together, Chosen as His Children.
Father's mercy, set apart to serve His Son, sanctified by His own Spirit, praise the Holy Three in One, saved by resurrection power, shielded in His faithful love, now no enemy can talk.
Some great singing this morning, some great songs. We're going to do something here in just a moment. As many of you know, and you should be aware of, the church in Ballground Community Church, has really just been taking off in recent months, and they've got their name now But they also just recently have found a location. So that's an answer to prayer. They found a location that they're going to begin meeting in the mornings. Okay, and so that means something. That means those that are meeting there will no longer be meeting here. And so that is a sad thing, but also a beautiful thing. And so we want to take just a moment this morning to pray for those who are participating in that church plant, okay? And so if you're participating in that, would you stand for me just so people can see who you are? If you're attending there, participating, so we've got a few here, couples, and then the Pulvers over here. Let's just take a moment. If you guys don't mind, remain standing for just a second. I'm going to pray for us, but would you pray, and maybe pray specifically for the ones around you, okay? But I'm going to pray, and let's pray for these families and for the Pulvers as they begin next week with morning services up in the ball ground area, that the Lord would just bless them, would continue to grow them, and that they would have not just God's blessing, but that there would be just an outpouring of the Spirit, and there would be a strong work of God in that community. And so would you pray with me this morning as I pray for these? Father, we want to commit this church plant to you. Lord, we already have. We have prayed multiple times, and we just want to continue praying. But Lord, now it kind of in some ways a beautiful, sweet, and yet sour thing that we are going to be saying goodbye to these families, Lord, who have been here and committed and just wonderful members of this church. And now they're going to be meeting in the mornings, a different location. Lord, I pray that you would have your hand of blessing on Ball Ground Community Church. Lord, I ask that the gathering there in Ball Ground would be a sweet smelling fragrance to you, but Lord, that it would be something that begins to permeate the community there, that they would know there is a church that loves you and that loves other people. Lord, that they would know that there is a place where they can find hope and they can find light. Lord, I ask that the church really would accomplish its mission in delighting in and displaying and declaring the beauty of Jesus to the Ball Ground area. Lord, I pray that you'd be with the Pulver family as they lead this endeavor. Lord, be with Tim. I ask that you'd give him special grace as he still manages a lot of workload here during the weeks, but then also leading the church plant in Ball Ground. Lord, I ask that you'd bring in his support, not just financial support, but also prayer support, that he would regularly be brought up before you by this congregation, that we would keep him before your throne, that you'd protect his family, you'd protect him, that you'd protect the members of that church, Lord, as they form. Lord, we cannot build your church. You are the one who is doing it. And so, Lord, we cast our cares on you. We cast this church on you. We ask that you would establish it by grace, that it would be founded upon the rock of the gospel and be a lighthouse in the area. Lord, we need you. I know these people, these individuals will need you, these families. And Lord, we just ask your help with Ball Ground Community Church. And we ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thank you so much. I do pray that you will continue to pray for them. Make it a commitment that you would pray for them. If you would like to support them or get on their prayer list, please scan that. You can scan that even right now. But I know they would love to know that you are on their team holding in some ways the lines, you could say, as they are starting this church. We do have scripture reading this morning as well, and so if you would open your Bibles to Romans. As many of you know, we have been going through a series on Romans. We took a few weeks of break from it, but Brian is coming back to Romans chapter 9. And if you remember, in many ways, the theme of Romans is that God truly is just in declaring sinners righteous. And he's just in declaring sinners righteous because of Jesus and his own mercies, okay, that are based in Jesus and Jesus' work for us. So that just kind of gives you the theme again of the book of Romans as we even approach this passage. But Romans chapter 9, we're going to begin reading in verse 14, and we'll read through 18, and then we will pray together and ask the Lord's blessing on this text. Romans 9, verse 14, it says, "What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I've raised you up, that I might show my power in you and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So then he has mercy on whomever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. This is God's word. Let's pray that he would help us to understand it and also to submit our hearts to it. Father, help us this morning as we look at this text in more depth. Be with Brian as he preaches. Lord, would you give him clarity of thought? Lord, I ask that your spirit would be working in our hearts, working in us to cause us to adore and worship you. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to submit ourselves to the text of Scripture. We'd allow it to rule our thinking and our feeling, that we would submit ourselves fully to you. Lord, I thank you that you are God and not us. But Lord, we can trust you, and we know that we can trust you. And I pray that you'd help us as we wrestle with this text this morning. Challenge us, stretch us, but Lord, help us to love you more. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
It is true that it is God's choice on whom he will show mercy. But also there's something beautiful in the scriptures. Another truth that kind of comforts our hearts is that whenever we cry for mercy with a sincere heart, the Lord hears us. Jesus said, whoever comes to him, he will never cast out. And I think the story that pictures this perfectly is the story of blind Bartimaeus. Do you remember him? The scripture says they came to Jericho, Jesus and his disciples, and as they were leaving Jericho with his disciples, with a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that Jesus of Nazareth was passing by, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent, but he cried out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stopped and said, call him. And when they called the blind man, saying to him, take heart, get up, he is calling you. And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And he said to him, Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? And the blind man said to him, Rabbi, I want to see. And Jesus said to him, go your way, your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. The Lord hears the cry of the desperate heart. The Lord loves to show mercy to sinners. Let's stand together now and sing a song entitled, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Let me at thy throne of find a sweet relief, kneeling there in deep contrition. Help my unbelief, Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou spring of all my comfort, more than life to me. Whom have I on earth beside thee? Whom in heaven but thee? Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by.
Those whom Jesus calls, he also keeps. Sing together.
I lift my eyes and see, I need not be afraid. All my help comes from the Lord, who the earth and sky has made. He will keep you from all evils behind you. Steps he has ordained for the one who holds the night is the sovereign of my days. He will keep you from all evils behind you and before. He will sustain you this journey from now and evermore. He will keep you from all evils behind you and before. He will sustain you through this journey. All evils behind you and before, he will sustain you through this journey from now and evermore.
This time we'd like to dismiss our children K-4 through the second grade out the back doors. You may be seated. Parents, if you're new to our gathering, you can pick up your children right across the hallway at the conclusion. Thank you.
Let me invite you to turn your Bibles to Romans 9. We will be there in just a moment. Romans 9. Let me begin by continuing to ask your prayers for our dear brother, Dick Hester. Many of you have asked about him, have been praying for him. Dick, of course, is one of our pastors here. He served as the lead pastor for 34 years and then went to work in the missions world and then, of course, came back when I came back here to continue to serve as one of our associate pastors. And many of you know that he has been battling sickness and it's a number of days ago that he was taken into hospice care. And he is up and coming, and he is open. I mean, he cannot communicate really well, but I think he can understand you, and he is open to visitors. His family has all come in. John and Jamie flew in yesterday. She had come in for a few weeks, flew back home, and then she's come back. And so, but really ask that you would be praying for the Hester family at this time, that God would just continue to give grace to them. Also want to mention to you, I mentioned this last Sunday night, Many of you know that, of course, our pastoral staff, with even what's going on with Dick right now, and you heard about Josh, God leading him later this summer to take the gospel to Utah. In reference to that, I mentioned last Sunday night, many of you have recognized Chris Anderson, the former pastor of Killian Hill Baptist Church on the other side of town, who's been attending our services now for here and there when he's able to. He works for Biblical Ministries Worldwide. But I mentioned last Sunday night that he has agreed just to help in various pastoral duties in an interim kind of basis when he's able to be around. He is a tremendous friend and a tremendous could be a tremendous asset to our church. He's been in pastoral ministry for decades, helped plant a church, and so you'll see him here and there and helping with various things, but he'll be helping temporarily in reference to some things, in reference to serving our congregation. This morning, Romans 9, we'll be there. I'm going to read a section of it. Many of you know who have been coming to Lebanon for a while that we have been making our way through the book of Romans, and we have been learning of the power of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, how God is in the midst of saving fallen people like you and me and transforming them into the likeness of His Son and saving them for eternity. It was a wonderful yesterday morning during our men's prayer breakfast. We got to hear the testimonies of two gentlemen, Ken Mueller and Clark McCauley, and they recounted the stories of how they embraced Jesus Christ, how God awakened them and called them by grace, and how they responded in faith. It was beautiful. In the book of Romans, we learn, of course, of our problem of sin, and how God in His grace brought about our rescue, and how He justifies us in His grace through faith, and how believers, once you have placed your faith in Jesus Christ, how you are eternally secure. Well, of course, we saw in the book of Romans in chapter 8 how this assurance is something that you and I can glory in. We have peace with God. We have the Spirit inside of us, and that nothing can separate us from the love of God. We have arrived now in Romans chapter 9. And in Romans chapter 9, Paul begins to answer questions. Some of those questions have to do with why is such a large section of God's chosen people, Israel, rejecting Him. Paul, of course, at the beginning of the chapter, shows his grief and his willingness to even be accursed for the sake of his kinsmen. Then in Romans 9, 6 through 13, Paul began to explain the last text that we looked at of how not all that descended from Israel are true Israel, and how everything depends on God's choice, the word election. In fact, it says in Romans 9, verse 11, though they were not yet born and had done nothing either good or bad, talking about Jacob and Esau, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, not because of works, but because of Him who calls. And how those of us who are in God's family are those in God's family, not because of any type of works that we have done, or not according to our own will, but how God chose Jacob before he was even born. And our text ended last time we were in Romans, where he says in verse 13, she was told, the older will serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. So we learned last time we were together how God is faithful to his word, and he's doing it by electing and calling a people to himself. And it's here that we arrive where Paul anticipates some objections. In fact, our text today will begin to address some objections that we'll throw up. We'll look at one this week, and then we will look at another objection next week. But today I want to continue to look at this, you could say what some people say, a controversial topic of God's election. And I begin with this by way of testimony. This truth that we will look at today is one that I had to grow to embrace. I was one that I think I've shared with you had the view, I called it maybe, this is kind of the 80s way of describing it, the video camera view of election. That it's almost like God videotaped what everybody would do and he'd see who would believe, and then he goes back and chooses the ones who actually choose him. That's kind of where I was, which that is not the view that I believe is presented in the text of Scripture. God had to take me through and lead me to what I believe is the biblical presentation of what this is. And you know what it was? It wasn't a really good relationship with somebody or someone who explained it really well to me. It was, in fact, the Bible. As I continued to read the Scripture and wrestle and take God at what he said in his word, that actually I came to believe what it says and what I believe Romans 8 is laying out for us. One of the big books that God used in the Bible was the book of John, Jesus' own words. Now, I know that some of you have grown up in church. Some of you have actually had pastors who have explained election away. Some of you may have gone to Bible college and says, I've never heard what you're saying. And that's okay. We're going to keep studying God's word, and we're going to continue to look at it. For me, I thought I was in some ways I better protect God from all these accusations. Let me tell you, God does not need my protection. I was also trying to protect man's ability to choose. Well, thankfully, this text God also used to help me and direct me and channel me into really, I believe, a biblical understanding of this. Now, let me just say here, please know that none of us fully understand this. If someone tells you that they got it all figured out, they're wrong, okay? But I'll tell you this, what I have had to do, even when I've tried to do the math in some of the ways with all these texts, that I have to surrender my understanding to the Word of God. It's almost like, remember when Martin Luther was standing before the Diet of Worms and he had come to the understanding that salvation is justification by faith, and he's standing against all of these people who are saying, recant, recant, recant. And he basically says, if you can show me that what I'm saying is wrong according to God's word, then I will change. But here I stand. I can do no other. And so, this is a truth because it's God's word and because I'm having to make my way through the book of Romans that we've got to go to. And because it's in God's word and because it's a teaching of God's word, it is good. It's a good truth. In fact, I believe the better you understand this, the more actually, you can worship God and praise him for his grace that he displayed for you. But no, you need to come to this topic, too, with a good and right spirit. You need to come to it with some humility. I like what Martin Lloyd-Jones, a famous preacher of old, said in reference to the humility you need to come with. He says this, "Let us approach this passage with reverence, but above all, let us recognize before we begin that we are not in a position to understand everything. Let us, in the words of the scriptures, remember that God is in heaven and we are on earth, and that we are not only very small and finite, but sinful in addition. So let us not expect to understand the mind of God fully. Is there anything more ridiculous than a creature such as man is, claiming the right to understand fully everything that God does and everything that God proposes to do?" So today, as we continue on this topic of God's election, let me say, don't quit and say, "I'm never going to understand this." Exercise some, you could say, heavenly elbow grease, and recognize that as we come to these texts, we're standing on holy ground. And what I'll try to do is I'll try to begin to give answers, but I will not give all the answers today. But I will tell you this as your shepherd, I hope that I will continue to shepherd you to green pastures as our Lord shepherds me. So let's look at the text, okay? Romans 9, 14 through 18. Let me read it to you again. "What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. For he says to Moses, 'I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion.' So then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, 'For this very reason, I have raised you up that I might show my power in you and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth.' So then he has mercy on whomever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills." Join me as I pray. Father, today, as we enter into holy ground again, as we study your word, I ask that you would order our steps in your word. And Father, may we submit all of our earthly human logic to the clear teaching of the scriptures. And may we today sit at your feet and learn from your word. And Lord, would you begin to help us to better worship you? In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever had something that occurred in your life that looked incredibly bad? You had a whole lot of concerns about what was happening, but then later, it was better than you could ever imagine. Okay, maybe it's a change at work. You're getting moved over to a new thing. Or maybe a company was buying your company and you're wondering, this is going to be bad. I don't like this. I don't understand this. But after the merger happened, after you understood everything, it was better than you could have ever dreamed. Maybe it was a date. This is not going to go well. This doesn't look like it's going to go well. Or maybe it's a child who goes on a date and is like, "I don't know about this." And it ends up, at the end, being better than you could imagine. Maybe you have a daughter-in-law or a son-in-law. "I am so glad we didn't give up there. It's so much better than we thought." I remember a while back, one of my friend's children had a tree fall right through their house. And it looked like things were going to go really bad in reference to everything. But after insurance came in, they did all of this remodeling. And I remember talking to my friend on the phone. He says, "You know what? It is so much better than we could have ever imagined how God took that we looked at like was going to be bad and ended up being good. In our text, Paul anticipated that some people would have real concerns about what he had just said. And they would make an accusation against God. So Paul defends the truth that he just said. Now, I will tell you again, I may not give you all the answers, but we are going to begin to head to the answers. Okay? And then we're going to trust God who has it all figured out. But today we're going to see this. The truth is in the text. It says this: God is perfectly just in showing mercy on some and hardening others. Let me say that again. God is perfectly just in showing mercy on some and hardening others. Now, we're going to cover five verses. And if you're someone who just kind of wants to get the idea of the verses in your mind, what happens in the first verse, verse 14, is he gives the objection and then he gives the answer. And he gives a short answer. And then what he does is he gives you two proofs, and both of them are scripture. He gives proofs number one in verse 15 and proof number two in verse 17. And then right after he gives each proof, he gives an inference or an explanation. And that's what he does in verse 16 and 18. And so that's how this verse just falls apart. But the first truth I want you to see is this: God is perfectly just. As I told you, Paul is beginning another one of what we call a diatribe. A diatribe is where he's kind of having this conversation with a debater who's like, he's putting the debate, the questions in this debater's mind, and he's answering them for us. And he's interacting with an objection that a lot of people would have. In fact, this objection is one that should naturally have come about if you understood what Paul had just presented in the previous context. What had happened in Romans 9, 6 through 13, is Paul had showed how God's choice of salvation for both Isaac and for Jacob was not based on simply that he foreknew that they would come to faith or that they had anything good in their resume. He basically tells us that the reason they are part of the family of God is because he chose them. It's because of his election. And so the question that a lot of us would have is this: it's not fair for God to choose to save people unconditionally. That doesn't seem fair. And guess what? That's exactly what he wanted you to come to. He said it clearly. And if you say, what shall we say then? Is there injustice with God? If that's where you come to in verse 14, it's because he did a good job on explaining exactly what he said in verse 6 through 13. If God picks some and not others, that's not fair. And so the text literally says, okay, if you were to look at it in the Greek, of course, what shall we say then? But it says this: not unrighteousness with God. May it never be. So Paul gives an immediate answer. If you're wondering, is God unjust in all of this? And of course, the word unjust is a word that's used sometimes for unrighteous, ungodly, or those synonyms. Is there anything unjust or unrighteous about God? And he answers, he says, by no means. God is just. In fact, earlier in the book of Romans, in chapter 3, verse 4, he says kind of the same thing when God is coming into question. By no means. Let God be true, though everyone were a what? A liar. And I'll tell you this. That should be the proper response. When you begin any type of questioning, is God wrong here? The right response of God's children when his integrity is questioned is, no, it must be with my understanding, because God's not wrong. My God is not unrighteous. God is not a man that he should lie. Is not the God of all the earth, like it says in Genesis, does he not do right? Yes. That's not his character. So evidently, who's the problem with? Me. We sometimes hear statements that are just, you could say for us, they're clearly wrong. Let me give you an example. Imagine hearing Pastor Mark hit a home run in the church softball game. All of you who know Pastor Mark, you're like, that's got to be wrong. That, number one, he wouldn't be playing in the church softball game, because last time I tried to get him in the church softball game, he ran inside the church building. Okay. And then number two, he's not going to hit a home run. Okay. Here's another one. Someone says, Pastor Brian preached a 5-minute sermon. Okay. You're like, that's out of his character. That's not right. The problem is that something's not right. I know this well enough. And for someone to say, is there any unrighteousness with God? By no means. It's me. I must not have the right perception. And as you think of God choosing ones to salvation, as it just says, do we doubt God? And he says this, there's no unrighteousness with God. And I'm thankful that God now, he begins to explain himself. So he asks the question, he gives a clear answer, and it's here that Paul begins to prove God's justice in predestination with actual text of Scripture. And so what he does next is this. Not only does he reiterate that God is perfectly just, he now says that God is just in showing mercy on some. God is just in showing mercy on some. And what Paul begins to do is he begins to prove that God's justice is true by bringing us to two texts in Scripture. As I already said to you, the first is in verse 15 and again in verse 17. Okay, and so just to make sure you guys understand where I'm going here, imagine that I said, I'm giving you a statement like we should not lie. And maybe someone says, why should we not lie? Well, let me give you two verses to show you that we shouldn't lie. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, and I take you to a text, and then I can take you to the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not bear false witness. So this is what the Bible says. So Paul had just said in verse 6 through 13 that God chooses people for salvation, not according to their works, and he does it before they were ever born. And then we think, okay, that's not right. There's injustice with God. And Paul says, okay, verse number one, let me take you to it. And what he does in verse 15 is he gives you verse number one, and then in verse 17, he gives you verse number two. And in verse 15, he says this. He says to Moses, and he quotes the Bible. And then in verse 17, notice he starts, for the Scripture says. So Paul, what does he do? He doesn't just say, hey, let me tell you logically why I think this is the case. He goes to the authority himself, and he lets God speak for himself. It was a while back that someone came up to me and said, hey, someone said this about you. I mean, is that what's going on here? And I was so thankful because they went to the the horse's mouth. Okay, they went right to, no, this is what happened here. This is such and such. In the same way, if there's any accusations against God, let's just go to God's word. What does he say? So God reveals what he says about this. First, he tells us God's words, and these are from Exodus 33, verse 19. So the quote in verse 15 is a quote from the book of Exodus 33, 19. In the context, what's going on in Exodus 33, 19 is they had just had the golden calf incident, and the nation, as many of you know, had rebelled while Moses had gone up onto Mount Sinai, and he was talking with God, and the nation said, "Where's Moses? Let's just go and do our own thing." And they talked Aaron into building this golden calf, and they started worshiping, and they were all guilty before him, and Moses comes back down, and God allows 3,000 of those people to be killed. And of course, you read the story of how Moses intercedes, and Moses again asks God to show him his glory, and God responds and says that he would make his goodness pass before Moses. And as God does this, he reveals a certain aspect of his character about himself. And look what it says in verse 15 of Romans 9. For he says to Moses, and this is what God told Moses, "I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion." In a nutshell, he says this, "I can give grace to whomever I choose." Now, even in the situation that had just happened, all of this nation had rebelled against him, and he allowed 3,000 of them to be killed. How many of them probably deserved to be killed for what they had done in that particular instance? Many. However, it says this, "I will give mercy," and the idea of mercy is acts of mercy, and compassion is attitudes. He says, "I will give acts of mercy and compassion, special demonstrations of my grace to whom I will." That's my choosing. What God is saying is that he doesn't have mercy on all. It is only on some. And it is the ones that he chooses. And let me tell you, that's not injustice. In fact, what should amaze all of us is that God would show mercy on any of us. All of us deserve hell yesterday. Let's just say that God was simply just. That's all he was. He was just. All of us would be condemned to death in eternity in hell. Because we are all dead. We were all dead in our trespasses and sins. There was nothing that we could do on our own. And God did not have to show mercy to any. However, God has chosen to show mercy on many, including us who have embraced Jesus Christ. I mean, stupid illustration. Of course, any illustration that I give is going to fail. But what if I today, after the service, wanted to give half of you a Lexus? Somehow I came under a lot of money, and I said, "Today, I'm going to give half of you a Lexus. And you guys can all leave home with it. I mean, leave church with it, take it home." A lot of you be like, "Oh, that's so cool. That's awesome." Until maybe you didn't get one. And you rode here on your bike. And you may be tempted to say, "What? That's not fair. Did I have to give a Lexus to anybody?" I don't have to give one to anybody. If I did it out of the kindness of my heart, you remember the parable? I mean, Josh and I were talking about this parable in Matthew chapter 20, where Jesus made agreements with all these people, and some of them, he says, hey, if you work the whole day, I'll give you this certain amount of money. And so they all agreed, and then he kept hiring people through the day. And then at the end of the day, he decides to pay the ones that he hired for the last hour the full amount. And what do all the people? What? That's not what? That's not fair. We can look at it a different way. Let's just say that everyone on the way to church today got pulled over for speeding, and all of you were doing it. Every one of you. You were guilty. And let's say the police officer chose to give a warning to 10 of you. Everybody else got the ticket, got the points, but he chose to give a warning to 10 of you. And it was nothing because of what you did. It wasn't because, oh, they have a Georgia sticker. Or, oh, their hair looked good today. Or, they gave me a smile when they came. You know what our pride would do? It's just not fair. It's just not fair. And the problem, you know who it is? It's with who? It's with us. Paul now explains the point. So he gives the quote. He says, this is what God says. I will have mercy on whom I will give mercy. I will have compassion on whom I give compassion. And so what Paul does is says, so let me explain this to you. Look what he says in verse 16. So then it depends not on human what? Will. It's not according to what you will. Because we often talk about man's free what? Free will. Or on our what? Exertion. But it depends on who? God, who has mercy. So did you notice it all starts with so then? Basically, those who are God's children are such not because of anything that they willed humanly. It is not our own free will that did it. It's not our exertions, because none of us could do enough. In fact, Titus 3:5, Paul says this, he saved us not because of our what? Works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own what? Mercy. By the washing of regeneration and the renewal of the Holy Spirit. It all depends on God's sovereign mercy. Period. It's God's grace. In fact, I love when I was talking to many of you heard Lauren Underwood's testimony when she got baptized a couple of weeks ago. And when we were meeting to talk about it, I mean, she very much expressed, I said, who did the saving in all of this? God just awoke me to the gospel. It was where finally God said, let there be what? Let there be light. That's his mercy. And he can do it to whomever he will. In fact, all of what he just said in verses 15 and 16 are supporting what he said in verse 13. He says, Jacob have I what? I loved. He had mercy on Jacob. He chose him before him and Esau had ever had a chance to make any type of decision. It's all because of his grace. Now, a lot of you are sitting here like, this is hard. It is. Because when we put it through our human processor, okay, and because of our own pride and because of our own, I can do this. I mean, I'm the Home Depot guy who gets the bucket and do-it-yourselfer. Let's do this. I can accomplish this. And when I realize, like Nicodemus realized when he comes and says, how can I inherit the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus looks at him and says, you can do, he He basically says, the wind blows where it listeth, so is the spiritual birth. You can't do your spiritual birth. Now, he will tell him, believe, and you know what? This does not negate your human responsibility to believe. But those of you who believe, the reason you believe is because Jesus graced you. He graced you. Otherwise, when you got to heaven, guess what you're going to say? Oh, I was one of the what? Smart ones. That's why he says, for by grace are you saved. Through what? Through faith. He uses faith, and this does not negate any of that. That's why you and I should be constantly heralding the message of Jesus. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That is a real call that we are to make. But anyone who comes, what does it say? Blessed are you. Flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father revealed this to you. So, God is just in showing mercy on some. Paul now gives a second scriptural support for his work, and this one's a little harder for us to swallow. And it's this. God is just in hardening others. He now brings us to a second text. Look what he says in verse 17. He says, for the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So what is he quoting from? Paul is now quoting from Exodus 9, verse 16. And what's going on here is this. Paul is interacting with the Pharaoh of Egypt, the chief man in charge, the one who had been likened to a god. He's talking to him prior to the seventh plague, the plague of hail. And God told Moses to tell Pharaoh that he had purposely raised him up to show his power over him and that his name, God's name, would be proclaimed in all the earth. Basically, that phrase, I have raised you up. The idea of raising up clearly speaks of God's own sovereign power over Pharaoh and how God was using him for his own purposes. He was like a pawn. The king's heart is in the hand of the what? The Lord. And he turneth it whithersoever he will. He is sovereign. God can do whatever he wants. I love the book of Jonah where it says at the beginning of the book, God appointed a whale. And then at the end of the book, that God appointed a worm. And in the middle of the book, it says, and God appointed a wind. God is sovereign over all things. He tells Moses in Exodus 4, who has made man's mouth? Who makes him mute? Who makes him speak? Who makes him see? Is it not I, the Lord? God is sovereign over everything. Paul states, basically, I've raised you up for this very purpose. He states it as God's choice. He states it in almost a matter-of-fact manner. And then he gives an inference. Look what he says now in verse 18. So then, he has mercy on whomever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. So did you catch that? Who does it depend on? Whomever what? He wills. It's his choice. Now, some of you may stop and say and point out, hey, Pastor Brian, didn't it say that Pharaoh hardened his own heart? And I would say, yes. In fact, it says it three times. It says that God hardened his heart a lot more than that. Pharaoh, was he responsible? Completely. He did wrong. But that's not to be minimized in the least. But before Pharaoh did any of that, the text said that God sovereignly willed what would occur. Now, as hard as that may sound, Lebanon Baptist Church, that's what the Bible says. And you say, does it really say that? Well, we'll do exactly what we did next week, as we did this week. If you're asking the questions in verse 19, then you're coming to the right question, because look what it says in verse 19. You will say to me then, why does he still find fault? For who can resist his what? Who can resist his will? If it's all his will, why does he find fault with me? Because no one can resist his will. If you're saying that, guess what? What I just told you is exactly what the text says. And some of you would say, man, this is hard stuff. This is grappling stuff. This goes against my logic. And you almost like want to protect God. I want to protect God against all these accusations. And let me remind you, does God need your protection? He does not need your protection. He can say it how he says it. And some of you would say, Brian, there's all these other questions that I have, and I'm wondering about this unsaved relative and this and this and this, and this doesn't quite compute, and all of this, and maybe these other texts of scriptures come to your mind, and you're saying this and this and this, and Brian, can I truly believe this? Let me tell you, you can believe the Bible. And there are times that he says things, and you are on a razor's edge. You've got to believe them. You say, Brian, do you believe all this? Yes, I do. Do I also believe John 3:16? Completely. Do I believe Romans 10, verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved? I do. But I don't explain away this, and I hold to it, and I bow in reverence, and the only reason I will ever be in heaven is not because of anything that I have done. It's because of what he's done in me. It's all according to his great grace. And this is what coincides with what he says in verse 13. Jacob have I loved, Esau have I what? I hated. And it's almost like the one he's using to explain the Esau side is Pharaoh. You say, how do I rectify all of this? No, I will tell you this, you have to submit to it. Some, those who are elected, some get mercy. Some get justice. But God gets what? Glory. I don't understand all this. And as I said, there's no easy illustration. There's nothing that I can come up with. I thought about a stupid illustration, but the Globetrotters. Who do the Globetrotters play every week, like every day? They always play the Washington what? Generals? You ever heard of this? So the Harlem Globetrotters, they put them on display all the time. They play different games, and they're always playing the Washington Generals. And I remember the first time I ever went to a Globetrotters game, I said, I'd hate to be the Washington Generals, because it's like they always what? They always lose, and they're on display. And it's like the promoter is this, and they've been chosen for that particular team, and this, and this, and it's like, but at the end, there's some glory that goes to the team that won and who got to chew all of this. It's like, I don't understand it. But God in his infinite glory, in his infinite display, I will tell you one day, we don't understand all that's behind the curtain, but I will tell you one day, this is what you will do. I don't understand it, but glory to God, that was the most magnificent drama I have ever seen, and worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And I will tell you one component that whenever I start having a hard time doing the calculations, that always helps me through is Jesus. The infinite God became flesh. He dwelt among us. And what did he do? He put himself on display. In him was light, and the light was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not comprehended. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came to bear witness of his light. He was not the light, but he came to bear witness of the light, that all men might believe through him. And you know what? He displayed himself. His glory is there. As he says in Romans, he has put it in creation as well, so that anyone who goes to hell, they are without, what does the Bible say? Without excuse. And any of you who go to heaven, the only reason you go to heaven is this. God. God. God is perfectly just in showing mercy on some and hardening others. So what does that mean for me? Let me just give you a few quick areas of application. Number one, I'll tell you that all of us have the propensity to question God's character. Okay? This was one where he puts it in our mouth. But I'll tell you, as you go through life, with the trials that you come and the questions that come up in your life, there will be lots of temptations. Sometimes it's not necessarily, is God fair? It's more oftentimes for us, particularly believers, is God good? Is God powerful? And sometimes what we can do is we can begin to question God and our human pride. And you better watch yourself. I will tell you, as I've seen it play out in so many people's lives, when you begin to start questioning God and his goodness and his control, problems come about. Most of the, you could say, the fruit of living a lie and living in our flesh comes because we do not come to right understandings of who God is. So if you're questioning God, get some other people to help speak truth into your life of who God is, because he can be trusted. And that brings me to the second area of application. It's this. When you begin to question who God is and what he's doing, don't go to Google for your answers. Go to the Bible. When that's what happens here. Paul just says, text number one, text number two. Okay? And you'd say, Pastor Brian, I still have some difficulties with this. What I will try to do as we interact is go to this text, and be humble about it. So be careful going to Google, because sometimes you'll run into very prideful people who will, they're going to lead you astray. And understand that some things are hard to understand, and this is one of them. In fact, when Peter wrote about Paul's writings, listen to what he said. And count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved Paul, also who wrote to you according to the wisdom given him, as he does in all his letters when he speaks in them of these matters. There are some things in them that are hard to what? Understand. Which the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction, as they do the what? Other scriptures. Number one, did you notice what the apostle Peter, the follower of Jesus, says about Paul's writings? He calls them what? Scripture. And he also says that some of them are hard to understand. So you know what? Point number one, Romans 9, 10, and 11. Okay? Let me give you a third one. I must trust God even when I don't fully understand. I love what Job says. Though he slay me, yet I will what? I will trust him. And I'll tell you this, as you begin to trust him, even in some of these things, I believe he will lead you to a place of rejoicing. The better you understand this. And one of the beautiful things about this, the more I take salvation out of your hands, because what we try to do is we try to take, oh, I think I did a little bit more. It was really me who did this and not God. The more I take salvation out of God's hands into my hands, the more trouble you're going to have. But the more you realize that your salvation is really not in your hands, it is in whose hands? It's in God's hands. And he awakened you. He brought faith into your life. He did all of that. So guess what that means for you? Nothing can separate you from the love of God. No human creature can. You can't even separate yourself from God's love because he set it on you and you are secure for eternity. And it's when you understand that, that gives you the ability to live out Romans 12 through 16. And then the final way of application is this. You'd say, Pastor Brian, how do I escape? How do I know that God will show mercy on me and then I can be God's elect? How can I do that? I'm glad you asked. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. If thou wilt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. If you're wondering how you can be one of God's children and you can be one of God's elect, very simply, all you have to do is place your faith in Jesus Christ. And any who does, any will come after me. He will not push you aside. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So what do you need to do? Believe in Jesus Christ. And then you know, the final thing is this. I'm adding a last application. You need to tell everybody about Jesus. And you know what? When you tell them about Jesus, realize that it's not depending on you. Yeah, he does tell you, how shall they hear without a preacher? Yes, but there is none of you that are going to bring your kids into God's family. None of you are going to bring your parents into God's family. Now, he tells you to go and tell. But any of them who come in God's family, guess who's the only one who can do it? God does. And I'll tell you this, I think all of us understand that when we pray. We're saying, God, open their eyes. And let's keep doing this. And you know what? There are many people in this city that God wants to bring to himself. And let's tell them about them. But as our truth we learned this morning, God is perfectly just in giving mercy to some and hardening others. Let's not put him to the test. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the truths of this text. Lord, as we continue to swim in the deep end, I ask that you would use these weeks of looking at these truths to deepen our love and our understanding of the greatness and the love of our God. May you cause us to worship you more fully because of what you have done. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being here today. Let me make the offer that I'm sure I know Pastor Josh, myself, if there's conversations that we need to have in reference to this, we'd love to have them. Stick with me. Come back we're swimming in the deep end, but please come back. Let's continue to allow this to change us and mold us. Before we dismiss today, let me remind you, those people you saw standing up, they're not going to be back here next Sunday. So make sure that you love them, be praying for them. Let me also say one thing. Another couple that I know this is their last Sunday is Owen and Marie Parlow. They're members of our church. Owen got a new job in Texas, and they are going to be moving this next week. And so this is their last Sunday as well. It's bittersweet. I performed their wedding this past year,
and they are just a sweet couple. You're going to find out about another couple next week who are, this will be their last Sunday. And so as we're saying bye to a number of our church family going to help plant, some of them going to help further God's work in other areas, let me say we need to fill their spaces. So we need a replacement for Owen and Maria, another couple. So go hunt them down, tell them about Jesus, and let's continue to fill God's church with more of followers of Jesus. Let me pray for the Parlows as they head out. And if you know them, let me encourage you to say goodbye to them today. Also was reminded, I ran into a friend from the past, Tatiana. She is a friend that came and visited. She caught me right before the service. She is one who has helped with many of the relief efforts with Ukraine. And she is a Ukrainian, and those are her people. And she happens to be here this Sunday. If some of you are interested in that particular part of the world and you've been praying for that, let me encourage you to talk to her. But let me close our service with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for all that you are doing in this world. Thank you for allowing us to be a part of it. Lord, continue to grow us in our understanding of the scriptures and continue to help us to take the scriptures to the world. Lord, would you greatly use Owen and Maria as you relocate them to Texas, fill them with your spirit, allow them to accomplish much work for you. Lord, continue to use the work of the gospel in the Ukraine as the gospel spreads, as the churches there seek to assist and help. We thank you for what you're doing in that particular part of the world. Now, Lord, help us to be busy about your work this next week. Help us to share the message of Jesus, the message of hope. We pray this all in Jesus' name, and all the people of the Lord said, amen. Have a good week.